Good morning. How are you? It's Friday morning, the 31st day of July 2020, just after 9:30. I'm Lee Med. It's a beautiful day across Dumfries and Galloway. Hard to believe, but a high today, it's going to be of 29 degrees. That's 12 degrees higher than it was yesterday. It looks like it's taken the whole summer to actually kickstart, but this weekend looks like we are most definitely going to be able to enjoy that. And I do hope you're going to enjoy the hour that you're going to be spending with us here this morning. It is the second of our virtual business breakfasts with our MSPs from across the south of Scotland. This morning, as always, if you have any questions for our guest speaker, who I'll introduce in just a moment, you can either pop them into the question and answer box at the bottom of the screen, or you can email them to me direct, lee.med@dgchamber.co.uk. So who are we going to speak to this morning? Who is our guest? Well, it's somebody that knows the region pretty darn well. In 2007, Colin Smith was elected to Dumfries and Galloway Council, representing the Nith Ward. In October 2013, he was appointed chair of the Planning, Housing and Environment Committee. And if memory serves, he was also the region's first events champion, something which I'm sure we'll come to throughout the course of the morning. In 2016, he was elected to the Scottish Parliament to represent the south of Scotland, and he is currently Scottish Labour's Shadow Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Infrastructure and Connectivity. I'd like to say a very good morning to MSP Colin Smith. Good morning, Colin.
Good morning, Lee.
How are you, my friend? How's things?
It's, it's very busy, I have to say. I suspect, like lots of the people that are on the session this morning, it's been a challenging time for a lot of people, but it's good to be here this morning to listen to what people have got to say.
As you say, it's been a very interesting, a very challenging 2020 so far. If we go back to January, start of the year, of course, we came through the official, quote-unquote, Brexit kicking off. We've got, of course, the transition period, which is going on just now. Then we had COVID having its effect in March of this year. When we started at the start of the year, obviously, how did you think 2020 was going to pan out? Did you think it's going to be Brexit and then starting to build towards the Scottish parliamentary elections? Was that how you had viewed 2020 going?
I mean, there was a number of things at the start of the year. I mean, Brexit obviously was the big shadow over everything, and the uncertainty that was likely to cause. Were we going to have a deal? Were we going to come out of the EU with a no deal? What effect would that have on the economy of Dumfries and Galloway? So that was the big issue. And it is still a massive issue for businesses, even the ones I'm speaking to at the moment, with the challenges we face with the current pandemic. The issue of Brexit is still very much looming there. And what sort of deal we're going to get, and what those trade deals are going to look like. But one of the things about the year was that I was looking forward to was the fact that a lot of work had taken place to get to the point where we had put the legislation through Parliament to have a South of Scotland Enterprise Agency. The Borderlands Growth Deal was coming to the fore, and we were really making progress on that. So there were positive aspects beginning at the start of the year. That in my view were going to help us try to tackle those enormous long-standing challenges that we've got in the economy of Dumfries and Galloway. But, you know, tragically we were hit by this appalling virus that has been a huge health crisis and a devastating impact on so many people in the region, but it's also developed obviously into an economic crisis as well, and this is something that we didn't see coming at the time.
I mean, we're going to talk on, we're going to touch both on the Borderlands Growth Deal and the South of Scotland Economic Agency, so the Enterprise Agency, throughout the course of the morning, which is great. But again, you say you've been speaking to businesses just now. Obviously, you've been speaking to businesses speaking to us speaking to you, lots of communication going on just now. Have you found there is what is the one common thread that has been coming through over the past few months? Is it uncertainty around where funding and support is coming from? Is it fact people just don't know what information to trust because there's that much stuff coming out? What have people been telling you?
Well, the first thing to say that very early on in the pandemic, I think like all our politicians, like you in the chamber, I'm sure we got contacted by a huge number of people, and it was the uncertainty. What does this actually mean? What do I need to do as a business? That then quickly moved into, how am I going to survive this economically? How is my business going to continue? What support is going to be out there? And that was a changing thing. Almost every day we had a new development of a particular fund coming from government, or changes to a particular fund, the criteria as well, and people were desperate to get information as to how they applied, what the criteria was going to be. So you spent literally hours on the phone simply trying to find people information to point them in the right direction. And as the weeks progressed, what became clear is that there were lots of gaps in the support that was available. And that's natural because these support packages were flung together pretty quickly. And you suddenly found out a bed and breakfast didn't have a business bank account, for example, couldn't apply for a particular scheme. A pub with a rateable value above 51,000, all of a sudden we're told you're over that level to get the business support grant. So there's been lots and lots of gaps. And one of my main jobs has been trying to feed into government to say, these are the gaps that exist for businesses. We need to find a way to support these businesses because they are viable. When we get through this, these businesses are sustainable, but the big challenge they have is just simply surviving the next few months. And it's been incredibly difficult. And we simply haven't known what was going to come next, how long the lockdown was going to last. And we still don't know what the long-term economic impact's going to be. So it's been a really challenging time to get people information. But my hat off to the businesses of Dumfries and Galloway who really have stepped up to the mark. And for example, looking at new ways of working, the number of things I get delivered at home, for example, from local businesses at the moment is fantastic. And so they've stepped up to the mark. But what we need to do as policymakers is make sure that we're there to support them. And that's what we're trying to do.
You said there had been some identification of businesses that had fallen through the gaps when these packages were first put together. How do you think the government has responded? Obviously, you have been feeding in, and we're seeing time and time again more support coming through. We found earlier this week new support for hospitality, which is great. We're still waiting to see what support is going to be there for the performing arts in terms of comedy in relation to some music and things like that. It's great that we are seeing more support coming through as businesses, as politicians and policymakers are beginning to see where these gaps are. But how much further can this support go? Because obviously there's not a magic money tree that is just going to be able to keep supporting on an ongoing basis.
You're right, Lee, and ultimately government won't be able to support every single business through this difficult time. And there have been changes, and the government have responded to a lot of the points I and other MSPs have made about issues to do with the criteria. But one of the things that I'm pressing for at the moment is a South of Scotland hardship fund for businesses in the area. And I've been speaking to the new enterprise agency and saying, look, the whole point of you being established was to tailor support to the unique needs of the South of Scotland. That was the whole basis why we passed the legislation in the first place. There are lots of businesses in the south of Scotland because of particular challenges around hospitality, around tourism, and the importance of those particular sectors that have missed out on grants. And you can have as many national grants as possible. You're always going to have people missing out. What we need is a local, in my view, South of Scotland fund that's targeted at those businesses that will come out of this. But at this moment in time, survival is the challenge. And we can have local support tailored to local needs. So I still think there's a role to be played in a fund over the next couple of months. And I see the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency as having a key role in playing that. And also what I've urged the government to do is to let councils retain some of the funds they got for some of their schemes. So we had the small business grant that was based on rates. That was actually underspent because the criteria was such that lots of people didn't apply, but they weren't meeting the criteria. So there was underspend in that fund. And it was a substantial sum of money, hundreds of millions across Scotland, not just tens of millions. And what I'm appealing to the government to do is let local councils retain their share of that money and support local businesses in their area with a more flexible type of fund rather than something of a national criteria. So there's a need for local support, in my view, and the need for that support is still as urgent today as it was at the start of this pandemic.
I mean, we would completely support and echo what you think there, Colin, because we do feel that there is a need to support the uniqueness of the businesses that we have here in Dumfries and Galloway. There is nowhere else in Scotland, I'd argue nowhere else in the UK, to be honest, quite like the breakdown and the economic breakdown that we have here in Dumfries and Galloway. But you mentioned the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency. And again, you're very loud and spoken, looking forward to getting that up and running. And it kicked off on April the 1st. Obviously, this came into a situation it had never planned on. I don't think any of us could ever have foreseen anything like this. How would you rate the agency thus far? Because it does seem to be a very mixed report card speaking to businesses so far. What's this? Almost 4 months into existence for the new agency.
Absolutely, and you're inevitably going to get that. I think the expectations were incredibly high. There was a lot of pressure on the agency, and as you say, it only came into being on the 1st of April. And I have to say, we've got a small team of staff at that particular time. And what they were asked to do by the Scottish Government was focus on administering two funds for businesses in their area. So they had the role of administering, for example, the Pivotal Enterprise Fund that came later, but also other grants around the hardship for the tourism sector and hospitality. So it seems to me their entire time was spent administering those grants on behalf of the Scottish Government. And that clearly was a huge job to be carried out, and therefore other things they probably planned to do when they kicked off on the 1st of April haven't transpired. I've obviously had discussions with the agency and what I believe needs to happen going forward. One of the important jobs they are doing is speaking to a lot of businesses at the moment and feeding that back to government as well. But what, you know, what we think we do need to see, I know they're conscious of this, is to step up to the mark and realise that there are specific challenges, as you say, we face in Dublin Galloway and the borders that they cover, that their aim, their whole need for existence is about focusing on tailoring support to meet those unique challenges we have in the area. And that's what they really need to focus on in the weeks and months ahead.
We were very keen in the build-up to the agency being launched, Colin. I mean, I sat at many meetings with yourself, both in your role as an MSP and when you were with the council in the build-up to this. And the one thing that came across was we wanted this agency to be something different. We wanted it to not just replicate what Highlands and Islands had done. We wanted it to take care of the communities that we were going to be going around as well. The communities, the history, the culture across the south of Scotland. Do you think maybe coming into this, I know there was talk when we were building up to the 1st of April, it says we're going to ramp up the staff, the teams over the 12, 18, 24 months, so they weren't coming in staff heavy. Do we think revisionist history is great, but do you think that was a mistake in the prior to the setup of the operation?
Yeah, I was very much of the view that, and one of the things that I raised at the time in Parliament was that the first year budget for the enterprise agency was lower than the second, the third, and the fourth year. And the argument was that the agency was going to be ramping up over a period of time, and that, you know, that was an argument that I wasn't hugely supportive of, but I accepted at the time the government were making, and I kept pressing for a higher budget, but they didn't achieve that. And I think, you know, we did have the predecessor of the economic partnership. So there was an opportunity, in my view, to put certain things in place that maybe didn't necessarily happen at the time, and maybe we've been caught out. I think the agency started. But there are practical challenges alone. This is a new organisation with a new team of people who physically haven't been able to meet as a team, for example, like many other people. They'll be doing Zoom calls and all the various other things at this moment in time. So just the practical challenges they'll have faced will have been, really, really challenging. You know, it's about what happens now. And, you know, it's about what support can be given to businesses in the weeks and months ahead, because this, you know, we've had a difficult time, but, you know, I believe that economically, we've just seen the tip of the iceberg so far. I think we are, and I don't want to be negative, but I do think we are on the edge of an unemployment crisis across Dumfries and Galloway. We've actually seen unemployment double in the region compared to this time last year. And what happens when that furlough scheme ends is going to be massively challenging and difficult for this region's economy. At the end of June, there were something like 17,400 people on furlough in Dumfries and Galloway. Now, hopefully, many of those people will have jobs to come back to when that furlough scheme ends. But that is no means certain for a lot of people, and businesses will have some difficult decisions to make. And the one thing we do know that's going to happen is that unemployment is going to increase in the region. So that support from the agency, from government, from the council in the next few months is going to be absolutely critical to families across the region whose livelihoods are at stake.
No, I agree. I think it's interesting. You say there it's just the tip of the iceberg just now. I've been looking at some of the figures. The claimant count in the region just now, the highest it's been in almost 25 years for those unemployment figures just now. It's potentially going to be absolutely massive. But how bad do you think it could get? But more importantly, how long do you think it will take to recover? Do you have any ideas at Scottish Parliament looking at statistics?
No, I mean, I think in terms of the challenge we've got, you know, I mentioned earlier the furlough scheme, 20% of the working age population in the region are on furlough at the moment. So how many of those people will have jobs to come back to? We don't fully know at this stage, because a lot of businesses will be making decisions at this moment in time based on the best information they have, but it will be no means perfect information. We still haven't allowed all businesses to ease out a lockdown, for example. So even just this morning, I was speaking to people who run gyms and their frustration that they won't be allowed to reopen until probably the 14th of September, though that may come forward. At the same time, we're going to allow people to go in crowds on a football match. So they're a bit frustrated over that. And, you know, what do we need to do for those organisations? And a lot, I think, will depend on what sector-specific support we see from government over the next few weeks. So we can't have a one-size-fits-all approach to economic support. We've got to look at those sectors that are going to come out of lockdown last, such as tourism, for example, at the moment is gradually moving back, but nowhere near what it was before. Somebody running a gym, for example. Aviation across Scotland is a big issue as well. So the government needs to come up with sector-specific support for those organisations, and I think that will, to a large extent, determine what will happen to those businesses over the next few weeks.
Keep your questions coming in, either in the chat box below or, as I say, on email, lee.med@dgchamber.co.uk. We've already got some of those coming in. We'll come to those in just a second. But if we can stick with that sector-specific stuff, there has been calls for the hospitality and tourism sectors really to get almost an ongoing three-month review every time when it comes to the furlough scheme. Do you think that's something practically we could see supported by the Scottish Government, or even this potentially the south of Scotland that we're looking to, hopefully, is going to come into development, knowing how important those jobs in that sector is to Dumfries and Galloway?
Yeah, I mean, I've been pressing as much as I possibly can to the UK Government to extend the furlough scheme. And it may very well be on a sector-specific basis. Those sectors that will be coming out of lockdown last will need support in the longer term. And I've been putting pressure as much as I can in the government to do that, because, you know, as I say, the one-size-fits-all approach to follow, it just is not going to work. In the absence of that, I do think, and this was a point that came across in the recent report by Benny Higgins of the Clue, for the government, that we do need some form of jobs guarantee scheme for businesses. We need something to give businesses as an incentive to retain staff as much as they possibly can, to support them as they gradually recover. So I think the number one priority, in my view, for government is to develop that jobs guarantee scheme to quite frankly, pay businesses a percentage of somebody's income in order to retain those members of staff, and ideally to take staff on, because some businesses are recruiting at this moment in time. If we go back to 1987, we had the New Deal for young people at that particular time. So we had a horrendous problem across the UK of high unemployment for young people. And youth unemployment was frankly through the roof. And that New Deal for young people supported businesses to take on young people and really substantially reduce youth unemployment. So I think we need a jobs guarantee scheme like that right across the UK. And the people that will have to deliver that ultimately will be the two governments, the UK and Scottish Parliament.
We are talking with Colin Smith, MSP, this morning. Colin, you were the region's first events champion when you were with Dumfries and Galloway Council. And we know one of our region's main draws is the event sector. The hospitality sector brings so much to the region. For so long, we've been encouraging people to come, to visit, to stay. So much to do and see in D&G. I'm thinking of things like the Stranraer Oyster Festival, the Wigtown Book Festival, which earlier this week, along with Spring Fling, announced plans to put some of their 2020 events online, which is great to keep the presence and everything else. But how can we, over the next year, 2 years, encourage visitors back to the region?
Absolutely. I mean, Lee, you're spot on when it comes to events. I think the challenge for Dumfries and Galloway when it comes to tourism, and it's hugely important to the economy. It's worth over £300 million a year. That's a huge investment in the region. We don't have a single thing, one thing that people come to Dumfries and Galloway for. There's a range of things that people choose to come to the region. It could be the fantastic beaches, the wonderful forest, and they go cycling, they'll go to the various things we have. My kids are, yes, we get back to the Cuma Galloway and the Cocoa Bean Factory, for example. So there's a whole host of things, and we have to package the region as an offer of different things. So when we come to Dumfries and Galloway, you can play golf, you can stay in a nice hotel, you can go and visit fantastic places with your family. And that's the strength of Dumfries and Galloway. It's about the whole package, not just one single thing. We don't have that one single offering. So what will be important, I think, and events were a huge part of that, and it, you know, it breaks my heart, a number of things that we've all been going to see over the summer that have just been put on hold, and we don't know when they'll return. All these things together is what is the strength of Dumfries and Galloway, that range of activities. And what we need to do is to focus on packaging that range of activities to people and make it clear that in the weeks and months ahead, Dumfries and Galloway is back open for business, that you can come to the region, you'll get a warm welcome, and all those things, and they may be in different formats, but all those things are still on offer. And at this moment in time, I have to say, one of our biggest strengths is a wonderful environment, a beautiful environment in Dumfries and Galloway. And you know, beaches are open, forests are open. If you want to go walking, you can socially distance easily across Dumfries and Galloway and have a fantastic, safe time in this region. That's a message that we need to get across.
Whose responsibility is it to try and get that message across, Colin? Because I'm going to hold my hands up and say, you know, I've been vocal in the past. I don't think Visit Scotland do a very good job of marketing Dumfries and Galloway, of marketing the south of Scotland as a whole. I think it's very much a case, if you're not in the central belt or up north, you don't really get much help from Visit Scotland. We've seen the new enterprise agency giving money to help Visit Southwest Scotland and the Scottish Borders, forming a new DMO, which is great. But in terms of Dumfries and Galloway, who should actually be marketing the region? Is it a DMO? Is it Dumfries and Galloway Council? Is it a partnership between the two? And who should be taking the lead on this?
I mean, I think you're absolutely spot on, Lee. I mean, it's one of the reasons I stood for the Scottish Parliament. It was because I was frustrated that we were very much the forgotten region. You know, you know people came up the M74 and they kept going north, they didn't turn left, or people on Estremuir say right as well. To visit our region, and that was a massive frustration. I want to go and bang the drum and say, you know, you need to take notice of this region, because we have so much to offer, but we need support from government to do that. So, you know, I think there has been neglect of the region. I don't think we've been marketed from national agencies particularly well, and I don't think that the focus has been there from government. But I think we've also got a job of work to do ourselves. You know, maybe one of the strengths of the Highlands and Islands is that they got their act together, they campaigned, they lobbied vigorously in the 1970s, and you know, they've now got their own university, they've now had their own development agency for decades, and we've been a bit behind. So I think it's a combination of things about trying to get government to listen, champion the region a bit more ourselves on occasions, and really, you know, sell the region a bit more and get people to take notice. And in terms of delivery now, I think it has to be a team effort. It has to be those national agencies such as Visit Scotland focusing on this particular region. It has to be the new enterprise agency, and I welcome the £2.7 million to set up the DMO, because I think what's important about that initiative is it comes back to the point again that there isn't a single thing in Dumfries and Galloway that attracts people. It's a range of things, and that whole DMO approach of selling the package of things on offer for the region, I think it is going to be important. You know, in the past, often some of our tourism businesses kind of looked at each other in competition, but actually it's about partnership and working together to say, we've got a wonderful restaurant here, we've got a nice hotel, can we work with the golf course nearby to sell that as a weekend golfing break, for example. So I think people working together is absolutely going to be the key. But I think still getting the message across to government about how important tourism is to our region. And there has been, I think, a frustration in recent weeks about maybe the signal to the north of England that, you know, you're maybe not as welcome as we'd like you to be. I think that's been a challenge for a whole variety of reasons. And I think we need to try and change that and say to people that you know, you can come to Dumfries and Galloway, be responsible, and you can have a safe, enjoyable holiday.
Okay, let's move on to another section just now that I know you're equally as passionate about, and that is travel and infrastructure. Earlier this week, you came out and said you were glad to hear about the electrification process taking place on Scotland's rail networks. However, you did highlight the fact that yet again, Dumfries and Galloway seems to be treated as a second-class passenger. No plans to electrify the stretch of rail between Girvan and Stranraer. We see the cost of tickets going up time and time again, especially from Lockerbie, as services there are suffering. Why, again, are the south of Scotland treated a second-class servant on the Scottish rail network? It's frustrating for us all.
You're absolutely right, Lee. I mean, we've been having a debate, or some people have, about whether we should build a bridge between Port Patrick and Larne. But in my view, we have a virtual bridge already. It's called the ferry terminal at Cairn Ryan. Nobody complains about the ferries. What they complain about is the poor links to get to those ferries in the first place. The A77, the A75, the poor rail links are just not fit for purpose. So if we want to strengthen the economy of Dumfries and Galloway, build bridges to Northern Ireland, then the first thing the government should do is invest in the A75, the A77, and improving rail links. So yeah, the announcement this week was huge with frustration. We're going to see our railways decarbonised by 2035, which is great for the environment. Diesel trains will be phased out. The biggest investment will be in electrification of the railway. So Glasgow to Carlisle through Dumfries and then will be fully electrified by 2035. That's great. But that part between Girvan and Stranraer, that link with the ferry terminals, won't see electrification. And that's down to numbers. Once again, if you have lower numbers of people using services, then you tend to lose out. And I think what government needs to understand is that if they want to tackle the big economic challenges facing places like Dumfries and Galloway, it is going to cost a bit more, you know, per person. There's no question about that. And you're going to have to make that investment in order to tackle the long-standing economic challenges that we face in this region. Electrification would mean quicker services, it would mean a more secure service, and it would give people that better link to the ferry terminals, just so important to the economy in this region.
Because again, railway seems to be encouraging across other parts of the UK a big resurgence, doesn't it? We're seeing HS2 progressing down south. We're seeing the Scottish Borders Railway. It's very much been a success. It's part of the Borderlands growth deal. We're seeing huge investment coming in over the next couple of years to Carlisle train station to update what's going on there. Earlier this year, the Southwest of Scotland Transport Study made a whole host of recommendations, including reopening stations at Thornhill, East Riggs, Beatwick and Dunraggett, as well as maybe expanding the Scottish Borders line to take in Langham. Have you got any updates on what has been going on with any of those proposals? Because it all seemed to come out at the start of the year and then has gone very, very quiet. And a lot of people were getting excited about the potential of these rail services at bringing life to some of our towns again and giving much greater access.
Absolutely, and one of the big things we're waiting for is the strategic review from the Scottish Government. So they published the National Transport Strategy recently, and linked to that will be the strategic projects review that they're carrying out, and we've been lobbying hard to make sure that a lot of the initiatives in the south of Scotland, like the A75, the A77, are part of that strategic review. I fully expect that review not to be delayed. And you know, the government will, maybe with some legitimacy, point to the challenges of the last few months in the current crisis. The reason for that delay, but you know, it is frustrating because you know there are so many good ideas out there about how we can improve the region. I've been, you know, I chair the campaign to reopen East Riggs Railway Station, for example. There's a similar campaign in Thornhill. This would open up those areas for people to commute. There's no question about that, if we could get to some progress on that as well. But there are even simple things that could happen pretty quickly, and they're not happening, and it's frustrating. People can't get a direct train into the centre of Edinburgh in the morning from Lockerbie Station. They still have to change at Kerstairs, which is a bit of a lottery if the weather's bad or the trains are running late, whether that even happens. You know, in this day and age, if we want to give people the opportunity to live in a region but maybe commute part of the week to our cities, then we have to give people those particular links. What's been interesting about the last few weeks has been the focus on home working. and the fact that people don't need to sit in an office in the centre of Edinburgh every single day to look out the window and make calls from there. They can work from home. And that, I think, opens up opportunities for people to, you know, to work part of the week at home here in Dumfries and Galloway, and they may have to go into their office in the cities other days. But that will only happen if we get proper rail links from Lockerbie Station in particular. And if we're serious about the climate challenge we've got, we need to get people off the roads into public transport, but you have to give them the public transport to make that choice.
It's funny you mentioned that, because we've had a question come in from Tony. He says, Lee, I live in the east of Dumfries and Galloway, and whilst we benefit from an excellent bus service between Dumfries and Glasgow just now, that is rumoured to be changing very soon. Moving elsewhere across the region on public transport is pretty hard at times. What changes does Colin see or know about that will change this for the better moving forward? So again, we've said there's got to be work done on the rail network. Public transport, again, is something that you used to bang on about when you were part of Dumfries and Galloway Council, like getting that backbone confidently secure across Dumfries and Galloway. Any changes that you know, or any changes that you could put in place or pressure people to give Tony a little smile on this Friday morning?
Giving Tony a smile might be challenging in terms of the fear I've got about public transport, I think, in the next few weeks, because you know, we have had a message over the last few months of stay off public transport, and there's a reason for that. We understand that fully. One of my fears is that, you know, having spent years saying please use public transport, we've now probably undone a lot of the good of that by saying to people please don't use public transport, take your car, and I think there'll be a big rebound effect as we come out of this, where more people will be using the car than they did previously, and that will be a challenge for us all. And one of the downsides of that will mean that a very precarious bus network already in Dumfries and Galloway will become more precarious, and I think we'll start to see, we've already seen a number of services being reduced, and you know, I worry that will continue to happen. One of the points in my party's transport spokesman in the Scottish Parliament, and I speak to the transport secretary on a regular basis at the moment, one of the points that I've said is that you're providing quite a lot of financial support at the moment for the bus industry. You know, they're given access to funds such as the money for the free bus pass for older people. Even if people don't use it, they're still getting access to that money at the moment. You need to put conditions on that. You need to say to bus companies, in return for this substantial investment funding we're given to support you at this stage, you need to retain services. And I think there needs to be more conditionality on some of that support, because I do feel that we'll start to lose services in the months ahead. One of the changes I got made to the transport bill when it went through Parliament is to remove the ban on local councils running bus services, because at the moment the best bus services in Scotland are in Edinburgh and Lothian buses, which is run by the local councils, and you know, I think we need something like that in Dumfries and Galloway as well, because you know, to complement the bus companies that are out there, to work with them and to deliver services in potentially those hard to reach areas. So I want to see that change being brought forward as well, because I think in the short term we are going to see services being reduced for the region, and that will be difficult, particularly for those people who rely on buses to get to work. Not everybody has a car, and they continue to use a bus to get to work, and we need to retain those services as best we can, but it will be difficult.
We've seen more and more people, as you mentioned, working from home during this pandemic. Many people are actually saying that they're quite enjoying it. It's allowing them trying to get a work-life balance in place. What people haven't been enjoying, however, is the, let's be honest, the patchy internet and broadband connectivity many parts of Dumfries and Galloway are experiencing, with the extra strain that's being put on the network. Of course, R100 always in the headlines the past few months. It looks like it's going to miss its planned timeline there. What can we do to put pressure on Openreach, on the providers, to make sure that Dumfries and Galloway as a whole gets good, steady, reliable broadband that can be used for working at home, so we can develop things moving forward?
Absolutely. I mean, I look at my inbox since I was elected MSP in 2016. connectivity, both broadband but also mobile connectivity, has been a huge part of that. Businesses, you know, I remember one of the first phone calls I took to the MSB was a hotel saying, they tell me I've got to take online bookings. Have you any idea how long it takes me to download that booking in the first place? So it's a massive frustration. 14% of people in Dumfries and Galloway still don't have super fast broadband. Now compare that to the national figure of 5% in Glasgow, where it is just 1%. So there's a digital divide in Scotland at the moment, and regions like Dumfries and Galloway are absolutely losing out. Now, the Scottish Government have given a commitment, as you say, to R100. So that's 100% of properties having access to super fast broadband at about 30 megabits. The original target date for that was by the end of 2021. Sadly, that target has now dropped to 2024 at the earliest. So that's a massive frustration for business in this region. I can continue to lose out. One of the things that I'm putting pressure on the government to do, though, is to make sure that they publish a schedule where different areas will actually see R100 delivered. So it's not just about the whole of the south of Scotland. When will we see that delivered for each area? And at least that gives people hope. We've got a target to look forward to, because one of the frustrating things people have had in the past is that when they type in their postcode, you see when they'll get super fast broadband to their area, it comes up where we don't really know. Sometimes you can see the green box at the end of your street where the broadband's going to come, and you think, why can't I get it in my house? You know, and people can't tell them. So at the very least, what government needs to do, and the providers like Openreach need to do, is to set up a clear schedule when each area is going to access R100, and we need to get on with delivering it, because it's massively important, and probably more important than ever before, after events of the last few months where home working has become very important. One of the final thing I'd say is one of the important points in the Borderlands growth deal was to push for a pilot scheme for 5G in Dumfries and Galloway as well. So, you know, a lot of people in this region, 4G is a football pitch. It's certainly not something they're going to get on their phone anytime soon. But you get it in the centre of Edinburgh, you get it in the centre of Glasgow easily. You get 5G now in those areas. We need to look at how we can make Dumfries and Galloway not just catch up with the cities all the time, but actually be ahead and give us a competitive advantage. So we need to see that happen as well. And that's certainly something I'll be pushing for.
You mentioned, obviously, the mobile networks as well, very important across Dumfries and Galloway. Many people are getting a better signal on their 3G handset than they are some of their home broadband. One thing that was spoken about quite a lot pre-lockdown, pre-Christmas, actually, we're going to be honest, was the single rural network, which was going to be essentially this big mast-sharing agreement between the mobile phone providers. How important is it that does remain on track, given the fact that R100 has indeed slipped by a couple of years?
I think it's absolutely crucial, Lee. I mean, it has been a frustration in the past that you have individual providers effectively doing their own thing. So you have a mast in one part of the region that will give you one mobile phone company, but if you've got a different company, you can't access that. So that sharing is absolutely crucial, and investment in that network is, as is trying to tackle some of these so-called not spots in the region as well, as making sure that, and there's a lot of work being done by the Scottish Government on this, that the Scottish Future Trust, trying to tackle, because there are parts of this region where you don't get any type of mobile signal, never mind 4G. In some of those particular areas as well, and that gives people a big disadvantage. So I think it's incredibly important, because more and more people are using their mobile phones to access broadband, to access internet, than they are using a laptop at home. And if you want to attract visitors to this region, people are going to turn up with their phone, they're going to want to book restaurants, they're going to want to do things online. But if they turn up and they're walking through a forest in Dumfries and Galloway, they've got no phone signal at all, it's a disincentive for people to come to this region. So it's crucial for the economy of this region.
We have got an amazing number of small, independent, of boutique businesses across Dumfries and Galloway, Colin. You've been a supporter of shopping local, of buying local, for as long as I can remember. A very big supporter as well of Small Business Saturday, which is great. How can we ensure that these small boutique businesses, some of them operating out of their garage in many places in terms of crafters and creators, don't get lost in the mix of the love to get back and try and keep the high streets? How can we ensure that these businesses have got access to retail premises, even if on a pop-up basis?
There's a very good point, Lee. I mean, there are something like 6,340 businesses in Dumfries and Galloway, 89% of those businesses employ between 0 and 9 people. We are a small business economy in this region. And one of the challenges, and you've heard me talk about this before, and one of the reasons why I think the Chamber is so important is that engaging sometimes with so many businesses is difficult because they're a small business. People have got their head down getting on with the day job of running that business and keeping it going. The last thing we've got time to do is to start speaking to lots of politicians. So the Chamber is really important in feeding that into us as politicians. And, you know, those businesses have stepped up to the mark over the last few months. You know, I mentioned earlier about the range of things that I've had delivered at home to support businesses, you know, butcher meat, you know, fruit and veg, I'll confess even cheese boards and wine, but we'll not mention that too much, being delivered at home. And what I would appeal to people is, as best they can, is to continue to support those businesses because they were there when we needed them and we need to be there at this time because they need us in order to do that. So the shop local message is incredibly important. And it will be difficult because families are facing a tough time. You know, every penny will be a prisoner at this moment in time, and price will be a huge determining factor. But if we can support those businesses, then we need to make sure that we do that. And that comes back to the issue I raised earlier about that financial support from the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency being tailored to the needs of businesses in this region. You know, online shopping, for example, is something that's a big challenge for us, and a lot of businesses are adapting to do that locally. You know, we've seen that even at a quick pace during the lockdown. But there are a lot of businesses locally that still, where people, and I'm quite old-fashioned, I like to walk into the shop, I like to look at what I'm buying, I like to speak to the person that's selling it. And a lot of businesses, that's still important in Dumfries and Galloway, particularly food and drink and things like that. So we need to support those businesses and not just simply say, well, the way forward is online shopping and you know, get yourself online. Those local businesses that are meeting local needs need to be given that support as well, because that's what their business model is. And that's still incredibly important. You know, older people and people like myself who don't want to shop online like to go into shops. So let's make sure we support those businesses as well, because without our small businesses, the economy in Dumfries and Galloway will struggle badly. And you know, for every one or two small businesses that take on an extra person in the months ahead, that will make a big difference to our local economy.
Our local economy very much going to be at the forefront of everything over the next 2 or 3 years, doing everything we can to get it back on track to where it is and taking Dumfries and Galloway forward. There has been a lot of excitement and a lot of promise in some quarters with the news about the Borderlands Growth Deal, the Borderlands Growth Agency. Of course, this was a project that took some time to put together, but now is very much, I'm going to say, up and running. It's there. It's been in operation for about a year now. I've been to a couple of conferences. Do you think, however, Colin, that the general punt to the businesses in Dumfries and Galloway, in the agency's area, actually understand what the Borderlands Growth Deal is? And I'm not being funny when I ask that question.
Absolutely, you know, I'm still not 100% sure exactly what it is yet, because you know we are still a long way from seeing those individual projects being delivered. And just this week, the next stage. It was noted that's likely to be delayed in terms of the final signing of the particular agreement. It's not there yet, and ultimately, I think we've got to be careful. I think it's going to be an important investment to this region. It's one that, you know, I remember being involved as a council in the very first meetings. It was like herding cats. All these local councils were coming together, and we're all sitting there thinking, "What is it we've got in common? You know, why are we doing this?" And it has been a long slog to get to where we are, but it still will work out as about £15 million per year over a 10-year period in Dumfries and Galloway in the Scottish border. So, you know, we've lost more than that in the last few weeks alone in terms of the economy. So it will not be a panacea for the economic challenges of this particular region, but it will make a difference. What businesses, and you'll know better than me, want to know is just when are the individual projects going to happen. They're not bothered about what it's branded as. They want to know when the investment will take place. And for example, making Dumfries and Galloway a 5G pilot scheme. People in the borders will want to know when the feasibility study into the extending the borders rail line is actually going to happen. They want to see dates on some of these particular projects. And one of the things I've done in recent weeks is that it's actually right to both governments and say, we shouldn't be delaying the Borderlands Growth Deal. You should be looking at ways to bring it forward and bring these projects forward, because these economic challenges that we face need investment now. So are there any of those projects that you can fast track to get delivered now? instead of waiting in the future. And it'll be the individual projects that will make a difference to businesses in this region, not necessarily what the growth deal is and how it's packaged.
You mentioned those individual projects are going to be the ones that make a difference. We at the Chamber have long been a champion of making sure every part of Dumfries and Galloway is cared for, is looked after to, and their voices and concerns are raised. And one part of the region that many people say often gets forgotten within the bigger picture of Dumfries and Galloway is Stranraer and the West. And I know for so long you've been trying to change that idea at a bigger scale. Now, one of the projects that is being funded or is going to be funded through the Borderlands Growth Deal is the regeneration of Stranraer. But I look back and think, we heard this story. In fact, I think I actually had you on the radio back in 2013, and we were getting very excited then about the prospect of regeneration on Stranraer Harbourfront and Stranraer Waterfront. How important is it that we make sure that single project, if nothing else happened, that single project actually comes to fruition and is seen through at this point? Because I think we can both agree that would make a huge economic difference to Dumfries and Galloway in terms of transport, hospitality and leisure. It could be one of the biggest turnaround stories that we've probably seen in the last 30 or 40 years.
Absolutely. And it's, you know, it's the waterfront and seeing that regenerate, it's been a passion of mine, and more importantly, the people at the Stranraer area for a long time, because it is a sad sight when you go down the waterfront at the moment, and you look at the old ferry terminal and the dilapidation there. You know, it is a kind of sends a signal about the economy and the challenges that we face in this particular region. So, investing in that marina and that area is hugely important. And one of the messages that I keep trying to get across to government is, look, I know that regenerating the waterfront of Stranraer will not be a massive growth impact on the Scottish economy. You know, it won't. You know, we know that if you invest in the centre of Edinburgh, it probably will have bigger growth impact in Scotland. But my God, what an investment that would be for the people of the west of Dumfries and Galloway. And it would attract more people to the region. And if you're serious about tackling those areas that are on the periphery, that are often left out, then you are going to have to spend a bit more. There isn't a private developer queuing up to invest in building shops and various things on Stranraer Waterfront. That's going to take government investment to really kickstart that. And we need to see that government investment coming forward, because it won't be cheap. I mean, we're talking about tens of millions of pounds needed in order to regenerate the marina and the waterfront in Stranraer. But if that was to happen, it would be a huge confidence booster to people in that area, and it would be a huge impact on the economy of the west of Dumfries and Galloway. And I think we're starting to see a recognition that place-based regeneration is important. It's not just about how do we grow the overall Scottish economy, how do we make sure that that's properly shared across Scotland. And I think that message is starting to get across. One way government can do that is actually to try and move forward with the investment in Stranraer Waterfront. And it won't, a private developer won't do it. It will take investment from government in order to achieve that.
It's great that we've got people like yourself, Colin, who are so passionate about the regions that they represent. But how difficult is it to actually get those higher powers, those powers that be, to come away from where they are, to take a day out, to come to Dumfries and Galloway, to come to the Scottish borders? How difficult is it to get that date in their diary so they can actually come and see things for themselves?
Yeah, absolutely. It's challenging, there's no question about it. I mean, I've been at meetings with government ministers in Stranraer, I've been at meetings with government ministers all over the place. I did one of the things when we were developing the legislation through Parliament for the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency. I insisted that we have sessions in Dumfries and Galloway and in Galloway Shields. I'd like to have seen more. But I wanted the politicians to come down to the region and speak to people locally. And one of the things I did do with the borders is make sure that they all got on the borders railway to do it at 5 o'clock at night, just to see how overcrowded that was. That was an experience for people. So they need to come and see the region, because one of the things that I noticed quite early on when I got elected, people say, where are you from? I'm from Dumfries and Galloway. Oh yeah, I've heard, that sounds lovely. I've never been, that sounds lovely. And this was people, you know, at senior level saying that, you know, and we've got to get more people to come down to the region and speak to people and find out what we've got to offer, but also what's needed in order to fulfil the potential. Because we've got huge strengths in Dumfries and Galloway. Over 10% of Scotland's agriculture, forestry and fishery comes from Dumfries and Galloway. We've got a stunning environment, we've got really diverse towns and villages, we've got lots of entrepreneurs, good strong businesses, a huge small business base, but we need that support from government to fulfil our potential, and getting people down here to see that for themselves is incredibly important. So it is difficult. We have made ministers come down here in the past. The important thing is that when they do come here, they listen to people and they listen to businesses and what's needed in the area.
All right, just time for a couple more questions. If we can keep you for another 5 or 10 minutes, that would be great, Colin. This one's came in from Graham. He says, Lee, it's generally recognised that young people are being hardest hit by the economic implications of COVID. Where does Colin think the government should concentrate efforts in dealing with these effects? And what in particular do you believe would make the biggest difference to young people's employment prospects in Dumfries and Galloway?
I think there's two parts to that, Lee. I mean, I think there's a long-term challenge that we've got here in Dumfries and Galloway around the demographics. So lots of people love to come to our region to retire, and that's fantastic. But because we've lacked the high-paid, high-skilled jobs, it's meant over the years that young people have left the region and continue to leave the region. And that's a long-term challenge. What's happened over the last few months has shone a light on that, but it's always been a challenge for us. And that's why things like the Enterprise Agency Investment and bringing those high-paid, high-skilled jobs to Dumfries and Galloway is as important as it was today, as it was 6 months ago. So that's a long-term particular challenge. In the short term, I mentioned earlier, I think there needs to be a jobs guarantee scheme, and I made reference to the New Deal for Young People that was brought in 1997 by the then government. I think we need a replication of that at this moment in time, with a focus on trying to encourage businesses to take on young people and give them those job opportunities. But there's still that big long-term challenge, and we'll only meet that challenge if we're able to deliver those high-paid, high-skilled jobs that mean that if somebody, a young person, wants to continue to stay in the region, they can make that choice. Of course, people go off and move to the cities, and that will always happen, but we should give people the choice that they can stay here and get a good job if they want to stay in our region. And at the moment, it's lacking those high-paid, high-skilled jobs, and that is still a big challenge for us.
Okay, and final question, Colin, if you can. Obviously, last night we saw Jackson Carlaw resign as a leader of the Scottish Conservatives. He said he didn't feel he was the person to lead the party into the upcoming Scottish parliamentary elections. Firstly, I'm assuming you're going to be standing again, which is going to be great. And secondly, do you think we are in a position coming into the next election where there's a danger of personalities being viewed over policy and politics?
Yeah, I mean, I think politics has become more and more presidential leaders. There's no question about it. And what policies will make a difference to people's lives is often way down on the debate. And you know, we need to try and move away from that, because you know those policies are what makes a huge difference ultimately to people's lives. But that's a challenge for us politicians. We've got to try and get that message across to people. And I think, you know, there are two big issues that I would like to see come to the fore in the next few weeks that are policy issues, not about individual personalities and politicians. That's pushing for that jobs guarantee that I've talked about a lot in the last wee while. But also an issue around a national care service for Scotland as well. I think we've seen tragedies in recent weeks in our care homes that mean we have to take a whole new look at how we deliver care in this region and right across Scotland. And in many ways, that's a bigger issue for Dumfries and Galloway than any other part of Scotland, because of the demographics and the region, how we care for people. It's also changing the care model is also an opportunity. It's too often social care can be low paid in a region, but if we can make it a more attractive role for people and support those care businesses across Dumfries and Galloway to make it an attractive job for people, that boosts the economy as well. There's no question about it. There are high-skilled jobs, if we deliver care properly, that can happen. So I think two issues, the jobs guarantee and pushing for improvements in care, can make a real difference to Dumfries and Galloway. And they are policies, they're not about the personalities of politicians. And let's try in the next few weeks. None of my focus has been on the election at all in recent weeks. It's about trying to support people, and that's been the case for more politicians. But as we start to have that debate towards next May, let's try and focus on the policies that will make a difference, particularly in my view, those regions like Dumfries and Galway where we're often forgotten. Let's make sure that the debate focuses on some of our challenges rather than just the big cities.
Colin, thank you so much for giving us your time this Friday morning. It's been much appreciated. If you want to go back and watch any of this again, it's very easy to do. From this afternoon, it'll be up online at the Dumfries and Galway Chamber of Commerce YouTube channel. If you have any comments or any questions you want to follow up with for Colin, you can get in touch with ourselves, dgchamber.co.uk, and we will follow that up with Colin. But again, if people want to get in touch with you, you're on social media, aren't you, Colin?
I am indeed. Facebook, I've got a website, colinsmithmsp.com, and my email address is colin.smith.msp@parliament.scot. And although my staff are working from home, working incredibly hard, you can still phone me on 01387 279 205, and that phone will be redirected to make sure we're there to help. And can I just say, Lee, a massive thank you to all the businesses across Dumfries and Galloway for the work they've done in keeping things going. You know, keeping us fed alone in the last few weeks during the difficult challenges we've had, they've really stepped up to the mark, and you know, let's give them the support they'll need in order to get through these tough times. And thank you to the Chamber for continuing to feed into us politicians what's needed to support those businesses in the difficult times.
Thank you very much, MSP Colin Smith. Keep an eye on our website, dgchamber.co.uk, for more events and webinars over the next couple of weeks. Have a good Friday.